welcome here in Washington. Chris?
All right, Sarah, I appreciate it. Let's discuss now with our political commentators, Jeffrey Lord, Trump supporter and former Reagan White House political director, and Ana Navarro, fresh off vacation. She is not a Trump supporter. Ana, let me ask you this, Ana.
Yeah,
what do you make of?
I wasn't a Trump supporter when I left. I'm not a Trump supporter now that I'm back.
I got you. We are clear on that. Help us clarify something else. You have Bill Kristol saying that there's going to be an independent candidate. He had this kind of cryptic tweet saying that there's going to be someone, they're going to be well-staffed, positioned to win. You've got the Libertarian Party that just put in Johnson and Weld. Do you believe that either can be a factor?
We just don't know, right? We don't know who the supposed third party candidate is. Is he a stud? Is he a dud? Is it a she? We have absolutely no idea. So anything we can say is speculative. I mean, I think there are some people out there. I think Mitt Romney might be one of those who does have a built-in operation of seasoned veterans, who does have the ability to raise the money in very little time, who does have the name ID, who does have the creditas, who's done it again and has the experience of running nationwide and knows where the pitfalls are. So I do think there are some people out there in America who could do it. Whether that's the person that Bill Kristol is referring to, we have absolutely no idea. We'll have to wait for the big reveal.
Are you worried? It's hard to judge, Jeffrey, what the tweet smack back of Donald Trump means, and he reflexively just attacks anybody that criticizes him. So how seriously do you think this campaign is taking this?
Well, we have to. I mean, Anna's right. We have to see who this is. I mean, frankly, if it's any serious Republican, that'll be the last time they run for office as a serious anything. They'll never be taken seriously in Republican politics again. I mean, this is, after all, for whatever they want to say, this is a pro-Hillary Clinton move. I mean, because that's what the result would effectively be. I just, you know, we'll have to wait and see who it is. But it's somebody who clearly doesn't have a political career and doesn't care if they want to ever hold office again, or somebody that is not to be taken seriously.
Well, there's no indication that it's Marco Rubio, but we do know, Ana, that he did say that he apologized to Donald Trump for the small hands thing, saying, you know, I told him that's not who I am. Is this his move towards Trump? Let's play his sound.
Now, and I actually told Donald at one of the debates, I forget which one, I apologized to him for that. I said, you know, I'm sorry that I said that. It's not who I am, and I shouldn't have done it. And I didn't say it in front of the cameras. I didn't want any political benefit. I'm not a candidate now, so I can say that to you. Not because of him, but because of me. You know, I didn't like what it reflected on me. It embarrassed my family. It's not who I am.
How do you take this, Ana? Is this in any way supposed to be seen as an embrace?
I really have no idea what Marco is thinking. I left. He was not endorsing Trump. I came back, and I guess he's going to be campaigning for Trump. On the apologizing for the small hands issue, I have to tell you that the Marco Rubio I know, him apologizing for something that he found was not in character for him, was not seemly for him, I think is consistent with a guy I know, with Jeanette, his wife, and the values they hold. I think he probably felt bad about that. And I think that when he tells us his family, his kids were embarrassed by it, he's being sincere, and he felt that he needed to apologize because it's not consistent with his character. He went out of character to do that. I think he was in character when he apologized. I think Marco's wrestling with what to do next in his life, with how to stay relevant if he's not going to be running for politics. I think it's very difficult to stop running for president. You're going from 60 to zero in one day. And, you know, I think he's figuring out his footing and how best to utilize his talents, his assets, and maybe help his colleagues in the Senate and in the House stay elected. And I want to tell you, I'm not sure, you know, what Jeffrey said before, that it's somebody that would not be taken seriously. The bottom line is we don't know who this third party candidate would be, and we don't know how it would play out. The one thing we know in 2016 is to expect the unexpected. So this notion that it might hurt Trump more than it hurts Clinton, we just don't know. I mean, this is the election, Chris, where lead floats and cork sinks.
Well put. Jeffrey, one of the big lines that Trump had this weekend is, you know, we have to do better by our veterans. Everybody agrees. It doesn't get done, but everybody in politics agrees about it, and then it doesn't happen. He then said, the illegal immigrants get treated better than the veterans. How?
Well, I mean, I'm not sure specifically what he's saying.
And
but,
that's the problem,
clearly,
isn't it, Jeffrey?
Clearly,
let's be honest. It sounds great. It makes you angry. It makes you angry
but
about
clearly,
immigrants. It makes you angry about veterans. Is there any basis of truth?
Clearly, Chris. Well, I mean, let's just take the case of the guy in San Francisco who killed Kate Steinle.
Right.
I mean, here's a guy who had been deported five times from this country, and yet he was welcomed with open arms by the city of San Francisco because they're a sanctuary city. I certainly have seen people homeless on the street wearing veterans uniforms. Now, what's the difference there? A pretty considerable one, I'd say. And so I think
one has nothing to do with the other. One has nothing to do with the other. They're both terrible situations. But in
no way can you
analogize that means that these illegals get treated better than veterans. It's just incendiary talk. That's all.
Chris, it's not incendiary if one guy is being taken care of by the city and somebody else who's a veteran is not being taken care of. I mean, the veterans should be the first priority
Absolutely, they should be the first priority. Absolutely.
My father was a veteran. You know, and while we're on the subject, Chris, my father had his life, and I am here because Harry Truman dropped that bomb on Hiroshima, and somebody needs to stick up for President Truman. It's not going to be President Obama.
All right, well, there's a little bit of a segue there. Ana, what are your thoughts?
Well, my thoughts are that before we continue the back and forth, today is Memorial Day, and I think we should give a thought to all those who've paid the ultimate sacrifice so that we can live freely in this country and have this bad choice between two bad candidates. But listen, I think it's apples and oranges, okay? We have got to fix the national problem with the VA. We have got to treat veterans better. There is absolutely no excuse for veterans dying on the waiting line as they wait for medical treatment. But it is a completely separate and different issue from undocumented immigrants, from immigration, which is another issue that is a must fix for our country. So we've got to figure out a way to walk and chew gum. We must address these pressing national issues. And no, confounding them and conflating them and overlapping them is not the way to do it. That's the way to fan the flames, and that's the way to confuse, you know, just stir the pot. But in truth, both of them require serious attention and solutions, long-term solutions.
And neither issue has received that to date. Jeffrey, the reason I bring it up is because if there's one group that doesn't like being used as political pawns, it's the veterans. All they want to see is action. We all know that here today. Jeffrey, much respect as always. Ana, good to have you back.
Thank you, sir.
All right. So speaking of who's going to be at the top of the ticket, the man who will be the Libertarian Party's standard bearer, Governor Johnson, the former governor.